Oh, ladies and gentlemen, Bucks and Brewers fans all around the world, welcome to another awesome and exciting episode of the Brewer City Lounge. As always, I know it's been a few weeks, but I am back. I am your host, Brandon. You can follow me on Twitter at @Wisco_Brandon. You can also follow the show on Facebook, on Twitter, somewhat on Instagram. Still trying to figure that whole world out. You can follow us on Instagram as well. Over at Brew City Pod. I'm very excited for you guys to be tuning in. There's a lot to talk about. We haven't talked in about a week and a half or so. So a lot to dive into when it comes to our Milwaukee Brewers. Like I said last time on the show, the Milwaukee Bucks are on a little bit of a vacation. So as they enjoy their championship vacation, we have plenty of Brewers talk. And I'm going to be quite honest with you, not a better person to have on the show today than our special guest, and bringing in the special guest. As always, the show is presented by Fanatics. So if you're interested in the new Brewers apparel that's going to be coming out here very shortly with that NL Central Championship apparel, hop on over to fanatics.com/BrewCityPod. Vinny Rottino, Bally Sports TV analyst, also host of the Lockdown Brewers, and really what we all know him as, former Major League Baseball player, former Milwaukee Brewer. Vinny, thank you so much for giving me a couple of minutes to talk to you. How are you doing today?
Yeah, good. Thanks for having me on, as always, Brandon. Anytime. Yeah, I'm doing
it's
well.
Good to hear. It's you're new to the Bally Sport, I don't want to say industry or whatever you want to call it. Could you have started at a better time? I mean, this is great for you guys. I mean, right. Yeah, not only a fan of the game, but a fan of the team. Fans are back in American Family Field, and the Brewers are one of the best teams in baseball. I mean, it's got to be a ton of fun going to work.
No, it is. It really is. Look, I mean, I was a player for a long time, right? And I started out as a Brewer, minor league player, made it up to the big leagues. In 2009, I was not a Brewer anymore. So you can't really be a Brewer fan anymore at that point. And I couldn't be up until this year, essentially. I was scouting for the Texas Rangers up until last year. So now I'm back being a Brewer fan as well. And not a better time to start this broadcast gig than right now. I mean, the team is kind of, can do no wrong a little bit at this point. And it's fun. I mean, I don't want to, again, I kind of joke that I'm going to get hit by a lightning bolt in terms of trying to jinx them, but they are playing so well. It's fun to follow the team. It's fun to talk about the team. I'm having a blast doing it.
It's, Vinny, I've been a Brewer fan my whole life. The first year that the Brewers made the playoffs, it was 2008. It was the CC Sabathia year that they acquired CC at the trade deadline. They went on that crazy run. I was actually in boot camp for the Army, so I never got to witness going to the playoffs and then experiencing that run. And then you fast forward to where we are now. It's just an amazing change of culture, whatever you want to call it, whether it's David Stearns or Matt Arnold. Obviously, Craig Counsell has something to do with it. When you look at this franchise, Vinny, looking back on just a decade ago, really, the turnaround is remarkable. Now, when you look at that, who is that? Who's behind that? Is that Mark Antanasio? Is it a little bit of everybody?
It's a good question. I think it's a little bit of everybody. I do think Doug Melvin and Gordash and that group did a phenomenal job with the Milwaukee Brewers and their tenure. I think at that, it's at that certain point, it was in 2016,
yep,
15, perhaps, 15, Antanasio decided to make the change and change regimes. And honestly, David Stearns made some really brilliant moves at the end of the day with the Christian Yelich deal and, yep, a number of the other. But at the same time, some of these players are still Doug Melvin's players, mm-hmm. So, I mean, I think everyone kind of had their hand in it. I do think culture at the end of the day in looking at all these different teams and all these different organizations, I think at the end of the day, it comes down to culture. And it that takes everybody, and it does trickle down from the top. I will say that. So, I mean, you could probably pin it on Mark Antanasio. I mean, he is the owner of the team. Leadership, good leadership, always trickles. I mean, thank you for your service.
Oh, I
mean, and you
that.
Could, yep. Yeah, for sure. I mean, and then you can attest to that, right? I mean, it always trickles down from the top. You have good leaders, good commanders, good, you know, people that can really command, you know, that team feel, mm-hmm. that, you know, everyone in it for each other, not for themselves, everyone in it for each other, then you get that good culture. I think the Brewers have had that for a while now. It's also the fans. I'll put it on us as well, right? That we're part of it. I really mm-hmm. do think that we're part of this whole winning culture thing.
Milwaukee's, you know, Vinny, you kind of been all around, you know, the United States, myself as well. And I tell people this, and this is, you know, this is the Brew City podcast, and I'm 100% biased, and I will always pick my team over anybody else's team. But I always tell people that it's something different about the Milwaukee Bucks and the Milwaukee Brewers. Milwaukee's a baseball city, in my opinion. You know, the Bucks won a championship. You know, 100,000 of us were down at the Deer District, and we celebrated that. But the Brewers are a little bit different in Milwaukee. They just, the city, it feels like, and this is just 100% my opinion, the city gravitates to baseball so much more. And when the Brewers are really good, and in this year we're seeing it, you know, it's a different energy. Two nights ago against the Phillies, it felt like a playoff game, and there was, I don't know if there was even 20,000 fans there, but the energy, it was loud on TV, from what I could hear. When you're at American Family Field, when you look at the attendance, you know, whether it's, you know, say it's a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, middle of the week kind of game, are you a little bit surprised that the numbers aren't as high as they maybe should be? And do you think that's because of where they are right now? They got a 12 game lead in the NL Central, 86 and 55, basically in cruise control.
I think that has something to do with it. The fact that it's not as dramatic, this playoff push, this playoff run. I think as the team gets closer to that magic number being zero, mm-hmm. I think you will see the stands, especially in that last home stand here coming up. I think the stands will be filled up. I do. The energy is there though. I gotta tell you, I haven't looked around when I've been at the stadium and thought to myself, man, you know, it's not, there's not a ton of you know, fans here. I always feel like there is, and perhaps that's because of COVID.
Yeah.
And the idea that, you know, last year there was no fans in the stands. So then just any fans in the stands feels like a lot. So I haven't felt that. I haven't felt that a whole lot. And again, the energy from that, this, you know, our fans and the Milwaukee fans bring to every game. I mean, the hairs on my neck are still standing up from that Daniel Vogelbach grand slam to walk off the game. But I've heard this talked about some. I don't know. I'd like to get your thoughts on this, actually.
We're real quick before I get into that. Were you at that game? Were you working that game?
I was working that game. Man. And I actually, and Craig Kishon and I were sitting there getting ready for the show. And I was just like falling asleep. It was like one of those games. Like, let's just get this one over with.
Come on, 5-1. Yeah.
I mean, there wasn't much happening after that. You know, was that the game where Harrison Bader hit that 12-mile-an-hour double down the line, and that's what kind of broke
that
it
was
open?
And yeah. and it barely, I mean, barely ticked Escobar's glove over at third base, you know, for it to be called fair. That was the inning where Corbin Burns, I think one ball left the outfield and like three runs scored that inning. It was, which always seems to be how a Corbin Burns start goes. You know, as frustrating as that is, that game, real quick before we move on, and I'll answer your question about the fans. My girlfriend was working in the backyard. We had our air conditioning on, so our house was all closed up, and she ran into the house because I was screaming so loud in, you know, pure joy that ball, as soon as that ball left the bat, I knew it. I mean, you could just, I'm getting goosebumps talking about it, literally. Like, you could just, it's one of those things, Vinny, and I know, you know, sometimes we're a prisoner of the moment. That is something, no matter how far this team goes, that is a moment right there. On the verge of having the best franchise record possibly, you know, as far as the record goes.
Yeah.
One of the best moments as a Brewers fan I can remember. Now, it's great winning the division in game 163. It's great, you know, going to the NLCS and having those moments. But that was special, man. That game was – most people wrote that game off. You're down 5-1. You couldn't get any offense going. The Cardinals got a bunch of cheap runs, and it just felt like one of those – all right, let's just get out of here. And it was just crazy. It was nuts.
Yeah. No, I agree. I mean, my brother-in-law was at the game, and I texted him. I said, hey, did you end up staying? And he said, no, thanks to my buddy Ty, we left. And so I was like, I'm tweeting this out.
I saw that.
I took a screenshot and tweeted it. Oh, my goodness, that was great.
I saw that. So about the fans, I'm with you. So, of course, the Philly series, we're recording this podcast, and it's Friday evening. The Brewers won. They're 7-3 in their last 10. They won their last few series as they beat the Phillies 2 out of 3. Of course, the only game that I take my family to, Vinny, was the 12-0 blowout that the Phillies took. I think they had like 4 home runs off of Woody in the first few innings. But it's definitely an energetic crowd, no matter what day. That was a Sunday that we went, and it was packed. It was the energy was there. It's still. Look, we're from Wisconsin. You know, we know that winter, old man winter is right around the corner, you know. So getting out and enjoying the weather as much as possible and to see, you know, 30,000 fans there on a Sunday afternoon and a beautiful day, the energy was definitely there. Every game that I've been to, it's felt like, I don't want to say it's felt like a playoff game because I've never said this to any of my listeners either before. I've never been to a Brewers playoff game. So I'm excited this year, now that I'm finally home, to finally get to one. So I can't tell you if it feels like a playoff game, but if I had to pick, it definitely feels like it. It feels like everybody's into every pitch when I'm at the game. And just, I watch Bally Sport Wisconsin, by far the best Brewers coverage, sports coverage in the area. And that's not just because you're on my show. I love what you guys got going on over there. It's remarkable what you guys got going on. But even listening through the TV, it sounds like every game is almost a playoff game. I mean, that's just my opinion. And that's just, you know, it's awesome to hear.
I think the fans just, and I've mentioned this quite a bit. I've been all around. I've scouted a number of different stadiums all over the country, and the Brewers, just the Wisconsin fans in general, they treat their Packers, their Brewers, their Bucks almost like a college feel, right? Mm-hmm. Whereas in the South, let's say, you have an empty stadium for the Atlanta Braves. Why? And I'm not taking anything away from the fans out there. What I'm just saying it's a different culture. They mm-hmm. value more their college sports. They're going to tailgate and party for their mm-hmm. college sports, right? Their SEC matchups. For football Saturday for them and stuff like that. That's more their just the fans kind of like go to. Whereas it's the Brewers, Bucks, and Badgers are in there as well, right? Yep. Obviously, yep. Brewers, Bucks, and Packers. So that is what is cool about and fun to be a part of being a fan up here.
So you mentioned Atlanta, so I got to say it because I lived in Georgia for four or five years, something like that. And you would never know. I had no idea, you know, if the Braves were on. I knew the Falcons were on because it was Sunday, but you just don't see it like you do here. And that's what I tell people. It's not to say that, you know, they don't matter. They're not as good as, you know, they're not as loyal, but it's just different here. That's just the truth. You look at, I know we're talking about the Brewers, Vinny, but you look at the Milwaukee Bucks and you had 100,000 people outside watching a basketball game that you had to like keep moving around so that you could see a little bit of the screen. And you don't see that anywhere. You just right. don't. It really is just remarkable. So we'll talk a little bit about
real quick.
This. Yeah, go for
real
it.
Real quick. I wanted to mention one thing, you know, someone mentioned, you know what my neighbor did. I was out in the neighborhood walking going for a walk with my daughter this evening. And he's like, he tells me, and I never thought of this. He's like, hey, it's between us and Tampa who's going to win more championships this year, right? Because the Tampa Bay Lightning won NHL Stanley Cup.
Yeah.
They have a chance. They have a real chance to be in the World Series, right?
Yep.
So do the Brewers. And then obviously with Tom Brady there in
yep.
So I thought that was interesting. Anyway, just keep an eye
I
on
never, who's win I never, more championships. Yeah, I never really thought about that. You're right. And then obviously right now we're tied up 1-1. Tampa Bay was there last year. They're another kind of, well, last year was kind of weird, but like they're sneaky good again this year that they're just one of those teams, which I'm fine with that the Brewers don't get the recognition. The only thing that bothers me about the coverage, like I would rather listen to Dario and Vinny and you and Tim, sometimes Tim, don't, you know, but, you know, I'd rather listen to you guys talk about our team, the Milwaukee sports teams, than I would the national side of it. But the one thing that bothers me is that Craig Counsell doesn't get the recognition, in my opinion, that he deserves. Now, and there's a couple reasons, I think, but I want your thoughts on why that is. Like, why in your opinion, what does the guy need to do? I mean, he's changed the way the game's managed. He's the longest tenured manager in the National League, and he's completely flipped this franchise around.
You know, I'm with you. I honestly don't know why. The only thing you can pin it to is the market. You know, our market is smaller on a national level. The Brewers are the Brewers kind of like the Giants right now, in that, you know, mm-hmm. that no one really, really believes. I think teams, you know, I think people around the country are believing in both organizations or both teams to be a serious World Series contender at this point. But it's September, mid-September, in order to get that recognition takes that long. So maybe, you know, that's it, just not the stage. But you're right, Craig Counsell has turned around this organization's he hasn't turned around the organization's culture. That's always been there, I do believe. But he's been able to navigate all these different roster moves, all these different players, all these different names coming in and out, just because that's the way the game has to be kind of managed, and these rosters have to be kind of managed that way at this point. And he's done a phenomenal job of keeping that winning culture there. He's done a phenomenal job of strategizing in-game. He just out-manages guys from time to time in certain games. He just flat-out does. But, yeah, he should definitely be getting recognition. I would be very surprised if he didn't get Manager of the Year. I don't know who else you could give it to besides maybe Gabe Kapler. Kevin Cash, perhaps. I don't know. All the, you know, the top teams. But I see Craig Counsell. I don't know why he doesn't get the recognition. I got to just pin it to the market size.
Yeah, and it seems like every year, and I understand there's, you know, other good managers are out there, and there's some that are just as worthy, if not, you know, more. But it just feels like a guy that's already playing a game, you know, going uphill, you know, with weight on his back, and trying, you know, competing with the Dodgers and the Padres and the Giants and the Cardinals and guys, you know, teams with endless amounts of money, and here he is, 31 games over 500, most of the talent on the team. Outside of a couple is our homegrown guys, you know? So it's just, yep. I just wish I'm just a Craig. I love the guy. I think he's the best in baseball. But looking at this team, turning the corner into, I guess we're about a couple days away from the midpoint of September, 86 and 55, 12 game lead in the National League Central. I have a little quote, you know, print the shirts already, 'cause it's happening. When you look at this team, how concerned, I know I use that term kind of, it sounds crazy when I just said all the things that I said. Willy Adames is on the IL. Tyrone Taylor is on the IL. You know, Freddie Peralta just came back off. Colton Juan is off maternity leave. Are you concerned at all with the injuries to Willy Adames or Tyrone Taylor? Two guys, in my opinion, Vinny, that are going to play key, obviously Willy Adames, but I think Tyrone Taylor's that fourth outfielder, in my opinion. Are you concerned with any of those injuries?
I think both guys are young enough. Here's my take as a former player of how I would think about these injuries as a former player. If I'm past my 31, 32 age, that's when I started really having soft tissue issues, and you see that pop up with a number of guys having soft mm-hmm. tissue issues after they get to that point in their careers. I think both of them are young enough where they're going to be able to bounce back with Willie. So I'm not really concerned with either injury. Okay. Willy Adames, just to kind of put it directly. However, I will say this: you got to hide Willy Adames's jersey in order for him to rest. Like, he loves to play so much. I mean, it's a good. It's like a blessing and a curse, right, for the guy, because he needs to rest at quad. I mean, I think he did it. There was a game that he you know that he was hurt, and he played for another 2-3 weeks where he was kind of nursing that thing, and I think he aggravated it. And I was working that game. I want to pinpoint the exact game. I forgive me. I don't really remember exactly, but it was a while ago. And I remember mm-hmm. Council came out and Willie Adames was like, no, I'm good.
I remember that. And, that was after that double. That game? Yep, I do.
Yep. And I think that's when he tweaked it. And if you do not rest these soft tissue injuries, they will haunt you all year long. I mean, I think I remember that with Paul Molitor. Remember he used to, tweak hammies and quads and groins all the time, and he wouldn't, ever really kind of get them right. And then they kind of nagged at him all year long. And I don't want that to happen. That's what does concern me about Willie. Get it right. I'm glad they put him on the IL. I'm glad that they did. He'll have plenty of time to ramp back up before the playoffs in terms of getting at bats. But he needs to address that thing. He is one of the most important pieces of this team if they want to win it.
2 weeks ago, I went on a rant on here how he was my NL MVP. And that's a whole nother conversation. Vinny, I'm biased on the show. That's okay. I love Willie.
Yeah, no,
when you mentioned that game, that was the same game where he, Craig Council went out there on second base. That was the same game he hit the go-ahead home run, and I think it was the eighth inning. And him and Craig Council had a funny moment in the dugout after that, because he was telling Craig Council, of course, I'm lip reading and whatever that,
Yeah.
He said, almost took me out and whatever. Real quick, on the injury side of things, Rock had mentioned it on the broadcast. BA pointed it out as well. Avi Garcia just seems like there's something bothering him. I don't know what it is. They said it might be a back issue, but it might be something that can't get any worse, but it's probably not going to get any better. Do you have any insight on that at all?
I got no inside information on that. The only thing I know is it's a back to nagging back thing. And sometimes when you get those back spasms as a player, it's not necessarily the swing. That used to pop up for me every once in a while. You'd get dehydrated or something, and your back, especially when I was catching, your back would lock up every once in a while. Most mm-hmm. players have that happen. I'm not saying that this is what's going on with Avi, but so it's not necessarily the swing. It's more like running, to be honest, that you bust it hard down the line and then you try to slow up and it just kind of grabs at you. So maybe that's what's happening. I don't know. We haven't gotten much information on this, but I'm with you in terms of something's bothering him, and it doesn't seem to be going away at all.
Yeah. Cause he had, it was just the, I want to say, God, was it the Philly series or was it the Cardinals series? One of the two. BA and Rock, who again, congratulations to Brian Anderson signing the extension to stay in Milwaukee. We love him out here in Milwaukee, but they pointed it out right away because he had a swing and Rock, they're just the best. Like they find everything, the facial expressions on guys and Rock knows it right away. And he had a swing and he started to go to first base and he got about a quarter of the way down the line and then he started grimacing and they caught it right away. And then he went out of the game and we just kind of, never really seems to be back to 100%, but a guy that looks like he is sort of getting back to 100% is Christian Yelich, batting .260. The OBP is up to .375 and his slugging percentage is slowly creeping up. When Christian Yelich goes to the opposite side of the field, that's like one of the most beautiful things for my eyes to see, other than Giannis winning a championship. Your thoughts as a former scout, as a former player, your thoughts on Christian Yelich, is it something to get excited about? Because I'm going to tell you right now, Vinny, if he gets going, that's it. That's World Series.
Yeah.
World Series.
I agree with you. I've been saying that for a while now. I think if we get the version of Christian Yelich from 18 and 19, I think no doubt Brewers are favorites to win it. I think Christian Yelich is looking right, not only with his swing and with his production offensively. I think he's running better. He's mm-hmm. taking chances in the outfield in terms of diving and sliding. He looks real comfortable sliding into bases, whereas it looked like he was tentative before after the back issue. Mm-hmm. I don't know if he had pain before and he was just trying to play through it, or perhaps he was very tentative, just not wanting to tweak it again. I think a number of factors has caused Christian Yelich to kind of have a weird year. I call it a weird year.
Definitely.
It's because of that. I think he was hurt and then he just didn't, this guy wants to win really, really bad. You can see it. You can sense it. It's on his face when he struggles. that he doesn't really care that he's struggling. He cares that he's not helping the team win, right? That's really bothersome to him. You can see that. And I do think lately he just looks more connected. I talked to Andy Haynes actually about this. He looks more connected. Andy Haynes and him actually got him to stay back longer on that backside, essentially, is the adjustment. And it has to, he said he has to overcook it, totally overcook it and feel like you're going to, he said, rip your quad in half, right? Just going to stay back there. And what that does for Yelich, this is why it's so hard to be a hitting coach, because everyone's different. This yeah. you would never tell anybody else that. Stay back long, because that doesn't allow you to transfer your weight. But Yelich okay. can transfer his weight, even doing that. And it's allowed him to stay connected with his hands and his turn, if that makes okay. sense. Before yeah. he was getting way out, flying way open, and then he was just kind of like flipping the bat at the ball, and it looked like he was totally lost and totally disconnected with his swing. And that's kind of what has got him back on track. And I can't say enough about Andy Haynes. We're talking about Yelich, but Andy Haynes has helped
him and
so many of these guys on the team. Yeah. That, he's got him back kind of locked in right now. I think the power will come as well. I think it's just a matter of him catching the ball, the bottom half of the ball. I think he's kind of just smothering the ball at times, but I do think the power is going to come as well.
The hate, I don't know if hate's the right word, but the criticism is the better word that Andy Haynes was getting early part in the season from Brewer fans on Twitter. I call it the dark web because it's just, it's horrible. And I remember coming on my show, this was in like May, this was before the Willy Adames day. And I said, just give them some time. I said, these guys still got to play. Like, you know, the players got to perform. Coaches can only do so much. But Andy mm-hmm. Haynes, Chris Hook, I mean, Pat Murphy getting booted before a game starts, legendary status. I love the coaching staff that Craig Council and David Stearns has put together. Now, speaking of these coaches, we'll talk maybe even Andy, if it has to do with Andy Haynes. I'll just say it flat out. What's your concern level with Kessin Hira?
Talk me off
the ledge, Vinny, because I'm worried.
Yeah. So, you know what? I haven't even checked on his numbers from the minor. I think it's a lost season for him. I mean, even last year, obviously it was a lost season for a lot of players with COVID, right. But he looked lost at times. Most of the time he looked lost when he was up, and then he looked totally locked in for a handful of games, and that's what gives me hope with him. I think he has an incredible ability to drive the baseball to all fields. I mean, he's I'm gonna say something that people are gonna be like, no way, but it's close. Okay. He's got Prince Fielder type pop, right? Mm-hmm. He can drive a ball to the upper deck the opposite way. Like Prince mm-hmm. Fielder did that, right? Yep. Ryan Braun has the ability to do that. And he's a little guy. He is a 5'10" mm-hmm. average athlete, right? I mean, he's not a below average athlete. He's got some burst in his running gait, and he can do some things. He's got some quickness and some twitch. But when he's got a bat in his hands, man, it is elite in terms of power, in terms of ability to drive the baseball. He looked lost, though. He did look lost. This happens. He's got to learn how to struggle and learn how what he needs to do in order to get out of it. He never struggled in the minor leagues. He totally just dominated the minor leagues. Comes up, they pick apart your holes quick in the major leagues, and then you start doubting yourself a little bit. I mean, we saw that with Yelich. He was doubting mm-hmm. himself pretty much all year, this year and last. But Yelich has learned to struggle through that, right? And next time he'll get out of it a little bit quicker, I'm sure. So it's hard to really kind of put my finger on what Kessin Hira is going to end up being, but I think he'll have success in major leagues. He's just got to struggle a little bit in the minor leagues, and you know, there's patience. I mean, Brewers can be patient with him. I mean, I think he's got another option next year even. So
he does, yep.
Yeah, so I think they're good there. I think, shoot, it would probably be the best thing for him just to continue to kind of work things out down there. And I personally think he's going to end up being a left fielder. That's what I put on him when I saw him in A-ball. I thought he's going to be a left fielder.
real quick while we're talking about Keston here, and we're going to look ahead to the future real quick, just because it just popped up into my brain. And I know that we have playoffs to look forward to in October and division crowns. Any chance, in your opinion, I don't know what the numbers look like as far as next year's finances, and I know that they apparently operated in the red previously. Do you think Eduardo Escobar is as gone as people think he is next year, or do you think there's any possibility that they're able to keep him in here? Because I think, Vinny, if you keep Eduardo Escobar, you remain one of – you probably remain at the top of the NL Central at the minimum.
Yeah. I mean, I think they're built to have another very, very good club next year, just in terms of their pitching and some of their core pieces. Yeah. I mean, I think they probably entertain that. He is 33, right? Yep. So, he is past kind of the age curve. I mean, did they sign Lo Kane at a similar age? Right.
They,
I
mean, did, you do. Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. You do see that they kind of regress. I mean, that age curve is real, yep. The analytics yep. behind that. So I would be cautious in signing him. I mean, a 1-year deal, I would consider. I mean, he seems like a phenomenal. This is the thing. Team does a phenomenal job of finding high character guys, right? And mm-hmm. guys that want to win. And that doesn't show up in any of the analytics, any of the metrics. But it shows up in the win column. It certainly does. And this is a guy that is part of that. Is kind of wired that way. And I do think, you know, they'll consider it for sure.
Yeah, I could see a 1-year deal. Kind of like if you remember with the Yasmani Grandal and Mike Moustakas following that 2018 run to the NLCS, losing in 7 games. They brought them back. They were both on 1-year deals. The hope is just there. And it was just something that kind of popped into my head. Now, I don't think we're going to look at some projections here. And Vinny, I think it's safe to say that they're probably going to win the National League Central. God, I hope so. if the Brewers right now, 86-55, if they go 11-10 in the last 21 games and they're playing right now, if they go 11-10, they will break the franchise record for wins. I'm not too worried about the franchise. I'm looking ahead to October. They win the NL Central. We can both agree that that's probably going to likely happen, which is funny enough because it might happen against the Cubs during their next homestand, which would be great. Realistically, Vinny, and I know we talked about Yelich getting hot and maybe turning into the player that maybe he once was, maybe taking him, you know, past that point that they haven't been to. How do you like the matchups that they're looking at right now in the NLDS and then possibly the NLCS, but the NL West is just a arms race right now. What are you projecting into the playoffs? How do you like their chances and how do you like the matchups?
So are we assuming that the Brewers get the 2 seed?
I'm going to go ahead and assume a few games behind the Giants. I think they're probably going to be very cautious with Willy Adames. If I had to assume, even though, like you said, you got to hide his equipment. So I'm going to go ahead and assume, you know, they're 4 in the win column. They're 4 behind the Dodgers right now. The Giants. So let's assume that the Brewers are the 2 seed and then they would get, the Phillies, I think it is right now, in the first round in the NLDS. Sorry, not the first round, but so if they play the Phillies and then they move on to the NLCS, which would be the Giants, maybe the Dodgers, I guess. So how do you like those matchups as they yeah. stand?
You know what? I'll be honest, all these teams scare me.
I'm sorry. The Braves are in first place. They got a really nice lead. That must just happen recently. I don't remember the Braves sneaking. They got a 3.5 game lead.
Yeah, the Phillies are a couple of games back of the wild card even, but that team scares me as well. I mean, I think the Phillies have a pretty easy schedule going the rest of the way. So they have a chance to overtake both the Reds and the Padres, I think. But whoever – so if the Brewers have the 2 seed and play the Braves, let's assume the Braves do win that East. The Braves scare me. They have a potent lineup. I like a lot of their players on their team. When I say like, I'm talking like a scout, right? I mean, I think there is some impressive – it's an impressive group of position players. the pitching staff. I mean, Morton shut the Brewers down. He's nasty. He's mm-hmm. been there, done that. Been in the World Series. Been in the playoffs. He's done a great job in the playoffs for the Astros a few years back. So he scares me. I know Max Fried has pitched well. Look, I like the Brewers' chances in all these series. I think it's going to just be a battle in all these different series. I do think the Brewers are matched up well to win the whole thing, right? With all of these teams, it's not going to be easy. There's not going to be any series, in my opinion, where Brewers are going to dominate right here. They're going to sweep. I think the fact that the Brewers have elite starting pitching, they have a number of different options for that four slot if they want to. They have a phenomenal bullpen. I mean, the game is shortened down to 7 innings the way this bullpen is pitched, mm-hmm. right? Brad Boxberger, Devin Williams, Josh Hader. I mean, these three guys, I mean, those two guys, Boxberger and Williams, could close for 20 other teams.
They could.
I mean, it's insane. So, you know, it's phenomenal bullpen. I mean, Aaron Ashby. I mean, that's a secret weapon.
Love Aaron Ashby. I was waiting for you to mention him because I just, yeah. God, I've fallen in love with that guy. I absolutely love him.
Yep. Totally on right there with you. I think he's going to end up a really good starting pitcher in the major leagues for a long time. But he'll probably pitch out of the bullpen for the playoffs and mm-hmm. kind of be that middle bridge guy in leverage spots. I mean, he's ready. He's not going to be overwhelmed by that situation. He won't be intimidated by that situation. And that's what I really love about him. I love his stuff, obviously. Disgusting stuff.
Yeah.
I do love his poise. Yeah, it really is. But I do love his poise, his mound presence, his instincts. Love all that about him. So, and then they have the lineup. All of a sudden, again, Andy Haynes and the pieces that they brought mm-hmm. in, they've become a team where they pass the baton to the next guy. There's no outs to get in the lineup at this point. None. I mean, they're mm-hmm. all tough outs. They're all a tough at bat, and it's relentless for opposing pitching staffs. So I think they're built to win it. They just got to go out and execute at this point.
What's crazy about Aaron Ashby, because I'm obsessed with him as a fan now, is that he reminds me a lot of, this might sound crazy, and you're way more educated and experienced when it comes to this, but his mechanics just remind me, not the talent or of Clayton Kershaw. You know, when he's, you know, when he delivers that ball, he kind of has that, he reach back, you know, that high leg kick. He just kind of reminds me a little bit of him, but he also is reminding me of what Corbin Burns served at for this team in 2018. If you remember, Corbin Burns came out of the bullpen during that run to the NLCS, and look where Corbin is now. And obviously I'm with you. I think the ceiling is sky high for Aaron Ashby, really for the Brewers. We're going to see Ethan Small here probably not too far down the line either. Maybe next year. I think somebody actually said next year was a possibility for him. Looking at the playoff roster, Vinny, I got to ask you, and I hate to have any negative talk on the Brew City podcast with the Brewers having the best game arguably in the franchise history. Jackie Bradley Jr., where do you see Jackie Bradley Jr. Going forward with this play, with the playoff roster? Is it tight? I mean, I know they got him for $24 million for the next 2 years. I don't want to rag on him because I don't like doing that to my own guys. Offensively, he's struggling. Defensively, there's not a whole lot better. And that's Major League Baseball wide. Your thoughts on going forward with the playoff roster with Jackie Bradley Jr. and then Tyrone Taylor eventually coming off of the IL?
I think there's room for both of them.
Okay.
And I need Jackie Bradley Jr. actually on the playoff roster just because of his defense. I mean, he's the kind of guy that's going to – he's going to come. I mean, we remember Andy Chavez with the Mets mm-hmm. back.
I do.
Making that World Series saving, game saving catch mm-hmm. over the wall. I think you're going to see something like that from Jackie. And I think you're going to see like a big hit or something huge from, you always see that in the playoffs, right? You see like some huge hit from a guy that you kind of struggled all year, weren't expecting it from. And then he just goes out and just balls it up because no one's expecting anything from him in the first place. It might be a little bit of more relaxed feel about him at the plate. So I'm expecting Jackie to be definitely on that playoff roster and then even contributing, to be honest.
Well, funny enough that we opened up the show talking about the Daniel Vogelbach Grand Slam. That was started by Jackie Bradley Jr. I mean, he had the double out to right center. So it was all because of Jackie Bradley Jr. starting out. And I'm with you. I love the signing. I praised David Stearns at the time and Mark A. And defensively, I mean, there's just when you have your starting lineup and now you got Luis Urias, who's just turned into an absolute stud since the acquisition of Willie Adames. Really no holes, Vinny, in the defense. I mean, there's really not. Omar's having a career year. You're behind the dish, at the dish. You look at first base, you know, you got a pretty good platoon going on with first base. Not many better than Eduardo Escobar at third base, and then scattered out in the outfield, you got a bunch of gold glovers. So it's not a bad problem to have. And real quick, before we do end the show, I want to ask you this. You're a former player. You played at the highest level in baseball, and you've been around the game for, you know, I assume your whole life. When the Milwaukee Brewers went to the Fizer Forum and they watched, they witnessed, they were there with their families, with their kids. They were watching the Milwaukee Bucks win a championship. They watched them raise the Larry O'Brien trophy. They watched the champagne. They watched the confetti. Does that have an impact on a team? They did it as a team. They were all there as a team. I believe, if I'm not mistaken, Vinny, I think a third of Milwaukee was at the Fizer Forum in some form or fashion. But when a team goes and watches in the same city that they play in, the same fans that were at the Fizer go to American Family Field, the same fans that don a Giannis jersey are wearing a Yelich jersey. Does that have an effect on the Brewers? Now they've seen it. They know what it's like. They kind of sense that feeling. And now it's okay. Now it's our turn. Do you think that has an effect on a team like that?
I do. I definitely do. It's the idea that, you know, it's okay, especially since Giannis is now an owner of the team and he knows some of these guys personally, like Christian Yelich.
Yeah.
It's almost like, okay, these guys aren't necessarily Superman, right? Even though they are to us fans. I mean, Giannis looks like Superman. It literally looks like Superman.
It does.
but he's just a normal guy, though. If you were to talk, Giannis used to show up at St. Catherine's High School basketball games to watch his brother play in Dominican, right? So, I mean, this guy is a normal guy. And so is Christian Yelich, right? I was in spring training with Christian Yelich when he was with the Marlins. I mean, it's a normal dude. He would sit there and talk to you like you was your neighbor, right? And I think when guys get to that level and perform at that level and win a championship on that stage, but then you can also sit there and talk to them and be like, okay, we can do, it's kind of the idea like we can do this too. We're going to do this too. Well, eventually you think to yourself, we're going to do this too. And that's when I think the team is starting to believe, and if not already have started, you know, have believed that they're going to win the World Series. But that's definitely a part of a good, you know, I guess part of that feel and that, you know, thought process of seeing the Bucks do the same thing and knowing some of those Bucks and kind of spending some time with those guys. I know that that has an effect. For sure.
I know I said it was the last question, but I got to ask you one quick more. Were you surprised at all about Giannis? And you may have had some inside knowledge that it was happening. Were you surprised that he took a part ownership of the Milwaukee Brewers?
I had no idea. Nobody that I talked to had
any. Craig's holding all the secrets.
That was happening. No, Craig was like, "Do you hear the news?" It was super cool. I mean, it's just investing in this city. Investing in the organization, it just goes to show what this guy is all about, right? Yeah. I mean, he loves this city, he loves the people. I think people fall in love with the people around here, right? And that's kind of why I love this area in this city. So, yeah, I thought it was awesome.
Awesome. That will do it for today's show. I mean, that was. I feel like when I have Vinny on, I feel like I can just. I have like 10 more questions and I'm like, okay,
yeah,
we got to cut it off at some point. you guys, if you're not following Vinny on Twitter, there's not a better guy on baseball that's breaking down the game, whether on the TV or through the Twittersphere. You can follow him on Twitter at Vinny Rottino. He's also part of the Bally Sports TV broadcast. You can check him out there pre and post game. Also part of the Lockdown Brewers. And do you want to tell people maybe where they can find that podcast?
Yeah, it's at Lockdown Brewers, and Jake Mastriani and I just talk Brewers. It's a daily podcast. At times I'm not able to be on it every episode, but I try and get on there almost every single episode. And we just break down the Brewers and we talk about the game of the night before, and just kind of break it down.
Cool. Awesome. Before we go real quick, Vinny, I know you're going to have to hear me talk for just a few more seconds here. For everybody that's out there listening, number one, thank you guys so much for giving this show a listen. I'm a super fan just like you guys, and having the ability to have a platform to come on here and preach about our favorite teams, it means a lot to me. So wherever you get your podcast, please do not forget to hit that subscribe button. But before we go, you can see at the bottom of the screen, the Brew City Coats of Hope. It's something that I started doing last week. If you follow us on Facebook or you follow us on Twitter or even Instagram, you can see the little video that I have posted. Starting yesterday up until October 15th, myself and some of my family, we're doing a fundraiser for the Afghanistan refugees. Now, everybody out there that knows about the show, that maybe knows me, knows that I am an Afghanistan veteran. So this is something near and dear to my heart. So if you guys are out there listening to the show, October 9th, we will be doing a fundraiser event at In Plain View out in Milwaukee on 700 East Layton. If you bring a winter item, coat, hat, boots, gloves, scarves of all sizes, children, adults, all kinds of sizes, you will be entered to win a prize. We have a bunch of prizes that we'll be raffling off. I will be doing a live podcast out there. So please, keep it in mind. If you guys are looking to donate for something, look at Brew City Coats of Hope. We will be collecting items till October 15th. We also have a GoFundMe set up. So if you're not in the Milwaukee area, you're not in the Wisconsin area in general, you can also check out that. And that would mean a whole lot to me and help a lot of people out, because Vinny, winter's right around the corner around this time of year. So we're going to enjoy as the nice weather as much as we can. But that'll do it for today's show, guys. Again, thank you guys so much for tuning in. You can find Vinny on Twitter, like I said a few minutes ago, at Vinny Rottino. You can also check him out on Bally Sports TV. And also do not forget to follow me on Twitter if you ever want to get some Bucks and Brewers biased opinions. You can follow me on Twitter at Wisco_Brandon. But that will do it for today's show. I hope everybody out there has a great day, evening, morning, wherever you may be. Have a great day, and I will talk to you guys soon. See you.